Hi, this is John Anderson of Yes.
Trevor Rabin here.
Hello, I am Chris Squire.
I am Alan White, the drummer with the band Yes.
Hi, this is Rick Wakeman.
Are you ever young, Bill Bruford?
I am Tony Kaye from Yes.
And here's Steve Howe.
Of course, there are three other people who've been in Yes who aren't present, which is four, actually. Trevor Horn, Jeff Downes, Patrick Moraes, and Peter Banks. To name but the most predominant. I mean, there was an earlier drummer, I think, as well, once. But we couldn't... Maybe we had to stop at eight on that basis that, you know, we couldn't duplicate, you know, three guitarists and three keyboard players. It would have been sort of insane. Well, in fact, it would have been four keyboard players, three guitarists, two singers.
Sounds like it could have been a little crowded, but just what is this all about?
I think there was a time when there were so many people that I was involved in under the banner of Yes, that it seemed logical one day to do a show, maybe in London at the Albert Hall, and make a film out of it or something, just for posterity.
Well, John Anderson's original idea grew a little. Eight of the most prominent musicians from Yes have reunited and released a stunning selection of music, aptly titled Union. Right now, they're on the road with Yes Shows 91, a worldwide concert tour. Hi, I'm Dan Neer. Welcome to part one of Media America Radio's Yes. Up close. Lift Me Up from Union. During the 80s, the current eight members of Yes have performed as two bands, with John Anderson providing vocals for both. The England-based gang went under the name of Anderson, Bruford, Wakeman, Howe. Over here in America, Chris Squire, Trevor Rabin, Tony Kaye, Alan White, and Anderson continued to perform and record under the name Yes. Their album 90125 topped the charts in 1983. 4 years later came Big Generator. The marathon tour that followed that album took its toll on the band and set the stage for Union. John Anderson.
It wasn't really a good unit. It was exhausted. It had spent 2 years making Big Generator album, went straight on tour, and was physically, mentally, spiritually not happening. So I moved on. You know, I went to Greece. And then I hooked up with Steve and Rick and Bill, thinking, well, let's see what they can do, you know. And realizing that they had a great style. And then I realized that I was working with both bands, and both bands had style, but very different style. You know, Chris, Alan, and Trevor, and Tony were a real heavyweight rock and roll, seriously big sounding band. And Bill and Steve and Rick were very finesse with Tony Levin on bass, you know, a lot of finesse there, you know. And I thought, gosh, put them two together, that'd be the way to do it. So that's how it really happened, you know, in a nutshell.
Bassist Chris Squire.
I've always thought that, you know, it could work. And in actual fact, it adds a new kind of substance to the music.
Guitarist Steve Howe.
The new album has made a big transition. It was, if you like, it was started as AVWH, and now we've shared the grooves, that's a good one. We've shared the grooves on this record with the other guys. We haven't exactly collaborated. I mean, John really has collaborated on both sets of material. And it's an interesting mixture of really two groups becoming one, not only through the grooves in the record, but also through the tour.
Thank you.
I Would Have Waited Forever from Union. Okay? Let's let Rick Wakeman explain how a band with two guitarists, two keyboard players, and two drummers actually functions.
Because of the two natures of the guitarists between Steve and Trevor, they're just so diametrically opposed. It's just been it's not a problem there. I mean, Trevor just seems to be capable of doing anything.
Trevor Rabin.
Just as far as the strings goes, he uses very, very different string gauges to me. And he uses very different amplification to me. We use very different kind of guitars. I think we just approach things very differently.
Alan is a very, very technically orientated rock and roll drummer. Bill is a technically orientated jazz drummer with what I call very precision, sometimes pretty, pretty playing. Whereas Alan, you know, build sheds and warehouses.
Alan White.
Our styles are not exactly the same, and they're quite indifferent drummers, but we're making it work so far. But we have to sort of a lot of things about who's playing what and what parts that are particularly identifiable with that person playing on that number in that era.
Tony, from the last time I heard him to he's playing now, he's worked, you know, stunningly hard, and he's playing very well. The great thing is we've got two totally different styles, two totally different sets of keyboard rigs.
Tony K.
I have three enormous kind of keyboard racks hidden away, whereas Rick has, 10 keyboards and 27 pedals on stage. So that is a difference, but it's turning out to be very good.
Steve Howe.
Still only one bass player, as Chris holds the all-time record as being the only sort of surviving member through all of the transitions.
Shock to the System from Union. Sly Stone gives Yes its first big break when Up Close continues. Up Close is being brought to you in part by Budweiser, the king of beers, with that clean, crisp, cold taste. Nothing beats a Bud. And by the Prudential, where we won't let you get it until you've got it.
Excuse me, a couple at random. Yes. What does European touring sedan mean?
The time? 1968. The place, London, England. Here's John Anderson.
I was working in a bar, cleaning up glasses and things every night and sweeping up, just to earn some pin money to keep alive and stuff. And I went in one evening, and there was a guy, a very tall guy, at the end of the bar. And my friend Jack Barry, whose club it was, he said, "You should go and talk to that guy, he's a bass player. He's been wanting to get a group together for a while." And that was Chris. So I just walked around and we just talked about what kind of music we liked. We just seemed to hit off the same ideas. And then within about 2 weeks, we'd found Tony Kaye. Bill Bruford we found in the Melody Maker, which is sort of a newspaper, and he put an advertisement in the paper, "I'm a drummer, I'm looking for a band." So we rang him up, and the questions you ask over the phone for a drummer are just bizarre. You say, "What kind of drum, have you got a Ludwig drum kit? Because if he's got a Ludwig drum kit, he's got to be good, you know. So have you got a Ludwig drum kit, Bill?" In silence, and he says, Yeah, I've got one." So I'm sure what he did, he painted his drum kit black so you couldn't see the name. Because it certainly wasn't a Ludwig drum kit. We found that out about 2 or 3 months later. It was a Sonar. It still sounded good, though.
Bill Bruford.
"I'm concerned with the kind of energy I'm putting out as a drummer. Am I cooperating with the other musicians? Am I making the other musicians feel comfortable? That's a daily challenge of being a musician. That's what being a musician is. It's great fun."
Yours is No Disgrace from the Yes album. The band had been together for only a few months when luck came knocking at their door. John Anderson answered it.
We'd rehearsed, we'd done a couple of shows, and we were sort of really full of ourselves. We knew we had something happening, we were sounding good, and we were working together as a team. Now, we lived about five blocks away from a club called Blazers. One Friday night, I think it was, Sly and the Family Stone was going to come and play there.
Chris Squire.
Sly had already started his tradition of not turning up, but for some reason or other, they were convinced he was coming that night. No, he didn't. And so the club manager completely freaked, but, you know, a friend of ours who was at the club, C. Sly, said, well, the only thing I know you can do is there's this band living in the next street, and I know they've got their van with all their equipment in. Maybe you should put them on. So that, yeah, we went down and played to this packed club, and we were pretty good that night.
We really got them going, and we were there. We played a great set, and the audience went crazy. And these are your business people as well. So the record companies were coming to us afterwards, says, "Are you not signed up? You're not signed up." And in fact, the manager of the club became our first manager. You know, within the space of a month, we played the Albert Hall three times. It was very, very big time all of a sudden.
Starship Trooper from the Yes album. Up Close will return with a Christmas treat for Steve Howe after this. Some people say. The Yes album was the band's third. It came shortly after the first of many personnel changes Yes would go through. Guitarist Steve Howe replaced Peter Banks.
It was Christmas. My family were pretty broke. The phone rang and it was Chris Squire, and he said, yeah, it's Chris Squire from Yes, you know. And I thought, I've heard a bit about them, you know. And he said, I'm looking for a guitarist. And they sort of tried me out, and I sort of tried them out. And then I went back with John, and he kind of said to me, well, do you want the gig? And I said, yeah, I think I'd like the gig, you know. I was impressed that at last I thought I'd met a group who could play. I've seen all good people turn their heads each day, so satisfied I'm on my way.
I've seen all good people. Chris Squire explains his unique bass sound in a roundabout way. Next.
Presenting two comedians.
I'm Dan Neer. Welcome back to Yes Up Close and John Anderson.
I can remember very much the idea of King Crimson coming along at that time, the beginning of the 70s. And we all started to realize there was a lot of us guys trying these wild left field ideas. So let's just join in the idea. And Fragile consisted basically of four definite tracks, and we had this idea of everybody having a little, you know, 4 or 5 minutes each to do their own thing, which really helped to expand the musicianship within the band.
Chris Squire.
I was partially responsible, especially with the roundabout, you know, bringing the sort of like the bass guitar role into more of a kind of an important thing. That happened completely by accident, actually, because prior to that period of time, we'd been working on our second album in our Vision Studios with Eddie Offord engineering. The first album he'd engineered with us, and we had this producer, Tony Colton, and it was in those days when
it was very hip to listen to things on headphones, okay? So Tony Colton, the producer, and this is the Time and the Word album I'm talking about, he had this idea that, well, when we come to the mix, I'm going to do the whole thing on cans. Now, the way the whole board was set up there, the cans were like kind of like these real kind of things and like that. And he's got the cans on and he's waving to where the office is, right? More bass, okay. Because there's no bass on these cans at all. And Eddie Gofford's kind of going, oh, okay, well, he's the producer. What happened was, is that, you know, we ended up with that second album with real loud bass and people kind of dug it. And then when Eddie Gofford, you know, actually became the co-producer on the Yes album, which was the following album, he kind of actually sort of like pushed that same motivation, you know, of keeping the bass loud. And then by the time we did Roundabout, you know, and you know, the bass was always mixed very loud on albums, and that's really how I became famous.
Roundabout from 1972's Fragile. Before the recording of this record, Tony Kay found himself at odds with the then fledgling synthesizer industry.
I was not only not interested, I was positively against it. Although obviously it was it was hard to see into the future what was going to happen with electronic instruments. I found it very frustrating, and I was a piano player, and I liked the nuances of playing the piano, and I liked to play the Hammond, and I found single note synthesizers and out of tune mellotrons to be completely away from what I wanted to be. So that was one of the disagreements, I think.
So Tony left and was replaced by ex-Straub member Rick Wakeman.
There's quite a legend that's grown up about what we did together during the Fragile and Close to the Edge days, and it's almost got out of hand. It's grown. I mean, I've heard stories that we played on the stages that were bigger than the auditoriums, that we had lighting rigs that encompassed the whole audience. I've heard tales that I was on stage with 100 keyboards.
Heart of the Sunrise from Fragile. Yes, get dangerously close to the edge after this. It was not only Chris Squire's distinctive bass that gave Yes its unique sound. John Anderson's soaring vocals would be hard for any singer to duplicate. Here's Chris.
Well, he is a pretty unique singer, which is obviously his value. Yeah, he just has a very much, he's very individual, and I suppose a lot of people, you know, a lot of people have tried to imitate him. I mean, I know some people are pretty good at it, but you can never obviously quite touch on the real thing, because whenever it comes to imitating anyone, people always think that the way that it's done a different way from how it really is. That's usually the mistake of most imitators, is they don't actually realize that the way something actually comes about is not the way they think it is, or the way a certain style is produced.
Long Distance Runaround from Fragile. The injection of new blood in the form of Rick Wakeman took Yes to a new musical frontier. Here's John.
The idea was that him and Steve could do things that were very tricky, musically speaking, and they just seemed to do it without even blinking. It was just so easy for them, and they spurred each other on a lot. And I think that they brought Bill and Chris and myself. The fact that they were working so hard together, it all brought the team together, ready for the next major musical move. And I felt then we were sort of on the verge of trying to stretch our musical imagination correctly as a group for the first time. And that's when we moved into Close to the Edge. It was a great feeling of experimentation and understanding we had. We were sort of, it's us against the whole Well, we don't care. We're just doing what we feel is the right thing, musically speaking. Because to do an 18-minute piece, 19-minute piece of music, and two 10-minute pieces of music for an album was not the said thing to do. You had to have a single. This was the first time that we didn't really talk to anybody about what we were going to do. We just went ahead and did this album. And it's, to me, the best Yes idea of music album that was put together in the 70s.
And You and I, from Close to the Edge. Rick Wakeman's vision of Utopia is next on part one of Yes, Up Close. The new Yes album, Union, is actually a combination of music recorded, for the most part, by Anderson, Bruford, Wakeman and Howe as one group, and Squire, Kay, Rabin, White and Anderson as another. The final product is a perfect example of Yes at its best. But perfectionists that they are, the members felt it could have been better. Rick Wakeman explains.
Because of the speed of the Union, because, of course, what we basically have here is two projects that have merged. Chris did some vocals on some bass on some of our stuff, and John did some vocals, obviously, on some of the original stuff from over here. But that the utopistic idea would really have been to stop. Look at it all. And say, okay, we'll have that, we'll have that, and we'll do that, and we'll do that, we'll redo that. But because of the speed of everything needed doing, and because everybody was doing other commitments and various other things, other musicians and other people were brought in to do, fill-in bits. And when you consider the eight musicians that are available, that's totally preposterous.
Hold still now for the moving information close to you. You could never force it in your life, this decision to break it. Without hope, you cannot start the day. It's coming. She went to see you.
Without hope, you cannot start the day from Union. Up Close has been brought to you in part by Budweiser, the king of beers, with that clean, Army Reserve. Let's get back up close with Yes's guitar wizard, Steve Howe.
I'm not so interested in the techno flash, the technical side of the guitar so much anymore. Maybe I was when I was younger. Maybe I will again. But certainly in the last few years, I've been kind of relaxing into thinking that I've already got to a certain point in not really so much in my career, but in my playing. And maybe I've got to sort of see what happens at that level before I move on into more entrenched, possibly instrumental or rock or acoustic. Maybe I need a phase where I'm really going to play acoustic, you know, for a lot. So I'm looking at guitar work as a sort of phase thing that it keeps changing.
The Beautiful Masquerade from Union. Here's John Anderson.
Silent Talking is a sort of very engineered powerhouse. I used to call it Yes Zep. That was before Yes came together. This was when we were doing ABWH. It was a Yes Zep lick, you know, with the ghost of John Bonham in the background, you know, bashing away on the drums. And it's really a very, very powerful musicality song, all about music and how in the Silent Talking, this is the chorus at the end, you hear more of what the beautiful world is all about. You know, in your silent discussion with your conscious, your higher self. We all have a higher self. I wish we were taught this at school. You have a higher self and you talk with it endlessly. And it says, don't do that. And you go and do it and smack right in the face, you get it. And the voice said, we call it our conscience. And we sometimes actually at school think, our conscience, you know? Nah, there's no such thing, you know? But there is. Your spiritual higher self always tries to guide you. I mean, Jiminy Cricket sang about it. Let your conscience be your guide, you know? Give a little whistle, wasn't it? Pinocchio, one of the greatest movies ever made. Silent talking.
Silent Talking from Union.
It's 1991 and it's very unique for this to happen, and I think that is really, I'd say, the reason why Yes has been able to carry on as an idea, is for this to happen, for us guys to push the barriers yet again, you know, and know that this is a unique position to be in. And at the same time, you wonder where it's going to take us, because we don't know. I mean, that's one of the interesting things about Yes music, is we never know really where we're going to go musically.
If you want to find out where they're going musically, tune in next time for part two of Yes, Up Close. As for the band itself, they're just about to start a tour of Europe, but they will return to the United States in the coming months. Be listening for part two of Yes, Up Close when we'll announce dates for the second leg of their North American tour. We'd like to thank Brian Lane of Sun Arts Music Limited, Tony Dimitriadis and Alex Scott of East End Management Company, Phil Carson of Phil Carson's Associates Limited, Ronnie Lippin and Shell Tarkington of The Lippin Group, Rex King and Mal Craggs, and Diane Gentile of Arista Records. Part one of Yes Up Close was produced in New York by Near Perfect Productions as an exclusive presentation of Media America Radio. The producers are David Bales and Jim Fahey. The executive producers are DeWitt Nelson and me, Dan Neer. Up Close is distributed on compact disc and is copyrighted 1991, all rights reserved. No portion may be used without the written permission of the producers. Join us next time on this radio station as we present Yes, Up Close, Part 2. Thanks for listening. Hi, I'm Dan Neer, and this is John Anderson.
It's 1991, and it's very unique for this to happen, and I think that is really the reason why Yes has been able to carry on as an idea, is for this to happen, for us guys to push the barriers yet again.
An 8-member reunited Yes is back, breaking down those barriers with a stunning selection of music called Union. For the whole Yes story, tune in next week when Media America Radio presents part one of Yes, Up Close. Hi, I'm Dan Neer, and this is John Anderson.
It's 1991, and it's very unique for this to happen, and I think that is really the reason why Yes has been able to carry on as an idea, is for this to happen, for us guys to push the barriers yet again.
An 8-member reunited Yes is back, breaking down those barriers with a stunning selection of music called Union. For the whole Yes story, tune in this week when Media America Radio presents part one of Yes, Up Close. Hi, I'm Dan Neer, and this is John Anderson.
It's 1991, and it's very unique for this to happen, and I think that is really the reason why Yes has been able to carry on as an idea, is for this to happen, for us guys to push the barriers yet again.
An 8-member reunited Yes is back, breaking down those barriers with a stunning selection of music called Union. For the whole Yes story, tune in tonight when Media America Radio presents part one of Yes, Up Close.
Hi, this is John Anderson of Yes.
Trevor Rabin here.
Hello, I am Chris Squire.
I am Alan White. the drummer with the band Yes.
Hi, this is Rick Wakeman.
Are you ever young, Bill Bruford?
I am Tony Kaye from Yes.
And here's Steve Howe.
Of course, there are three other people who've been in Yes who aren't present, which is four, actually. Trevor Horn, Jeff Downes, Patrick Moraes, and Peter Banks. To name but the most predominant. I mean, there was an earlier drummer, I think, as well, once. But we couldn't... Maybe we had to stop at eight on that basis that... You know, we couldn't duplicate, you know, three guitarists and three keyboard players. It would have been sort of insane. Well, in fact, it would have been four keyboard players, three guitarists, two singers.
Sounds like it could have been a little crowded, but just what is this all about?
I think there was a time when there were so many people that I was involved in under the banner of Yes that it seemed logical one day to do a show, maybe in London at the Albert Hall, and make a film out of it or something, just for posterity.
Well, John Anderson's original idea grew a little. Eight of the most prominent musicians from Yes have reunited and released a stunning selection of music aptly titled Union. Right now, they're on the road with Yes Shows 91, a worldwide concert tour. Hi, I'm Dan Neer. Welcome to part one of Media America Radio's Yes. Up close.